definitely some variety in all of it. However, take a look as looks like off to the start, LATAM North. They have locked in something we haven't seen so far. It is going to be the Echo, but fortunately we won't see him playing tank.
Yeah, Evan RL can also pick, you know, half tanky items, Glacial Shrouds, things like that are always available for you to pick. Another thing that isn't really a surprise whatsoever is actually the Diana. I was shocked we didn't see it in the last game because of how powerful it has been today. Say is able to get that one for Team Ice.
Yeah, we're going to have Rengar on Rengar in the jungle as well, as both Audi and Revolta have picked that up, and the LeBlancs are locked for the top laners. So a lot of teleports on this squad too. This early game is going to get wacky.
Interestingly enough as well, Kami has chosen to lock in the Kassadin, and he's going to be playing that. I guess that's a historical throwback where Kami is just saying, you know, I used to be a god, I'm now a god again at the Assassins, and Kassadin was one of the OGs that everybody used to play in the middle lane. He is going to be against the Diana, which is effectively a free level 6, and Diana with a free level 6, pretty nasty.
Yep, we saw what could happen when a Diana gets unchecked on the map. A lot of mirror matchups, though. Two Pantheon supports. Normally, we've been seeing the mismatch with one in the top and one in the bottom, but with both LeBlancs going topside, this is going to be a little different. Yang is a terrifying player. I am not sure if I want to see what he's going to do with LeBlanc.
I just... Yang against Porky, two LeBlancs in the top lane is a little bit weird to, I guess, expect. No one would have predicted that happening.
I mean, he plays Echo in regular.
Yeah, but I mean, he's not playing Echo now. It's going to be the AD carry on the opposite side. But two LeBlancs in the top lane, two Rengars in the jungle, a heavy hitting bottom lane with guaranteed stuns. And the interesting thing to me that we have to highlight is that they have two guaranteed stuns in a really, really strong duo lane on the side of Team Ice.
I think we'll be in for those 5v5s as soon as the towers start falling down once again. That's the best part of it. Of course, if you guys think that Team Ice can come up with a victory here and at least take one win in the Assassin mode, hashtag LAN win is your cue at LOL Esports is the place. If you think that the Titans from Brazil are going to take this one, hashtag BR win at the same place. If Team Fire is going to keep on rolling and go 4-0 in Assassin mode, we're about to find out as we hit Summoner's Rift.
As we hit it, we also we have to scrutinize the skin selection here from Seiya. Perhaps he forgot that Diana has really cool ones and he's not Infernal.
Maybe he's just trying to channel his inner Faker.
I just, like, Infernal's just too cool not to have.
No, you're not wrong. There's a good reason why, too. It even comes from the same name team taking out the last All-Stars, winning the last All-Stars, I should say.
Yeah, maybe he's just saying, you know, screw Team Fire. Can't
have Infernal. It's out for himself this game?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm curious to see what Kami does on this Kassadin. He's not gone for the teleport. He goes Ignite. We haven't really talked about some of the other selections. PBO on this 80 carry Ahri. Seen a few different builds. Some AP, some hybrid damage.
Yep, was the last to lock in as well on his team, so undecided perhaps, or just being slow. Locking the Ahri means, I guess, the standard bottom lane as far as Assassin standards are concerned for a 2v2. It could be a little bit more challenging for Evan RL and Nezul to actually farm in this lane. I guess it comes down to how that level 1 progresses, as they are looking to be quite aggressive.
Yeah, I think a lot of the X factor is going to be the difference between Ner'Zhul and Dude. Running the same summoners, same starting items.
What happens when two Rengars ult? They can, like, can they see each other and they're both invisible? Like, what happens there?
I think we'll have to just find that out.
Yeah.
I would imagine with the way this game should shape out, Revolta and Audi will run smack dab into each other at some point.
Speaking of which.
As Evan is going to be escorting him up towards red buff. Revolta and Yang don't know this is coming.
They found they're in.
Oh, and they jump right for Revolta. Not even turned on the red buff till just now, and this is a bit of a pickle. Revolta jumps in, takes the red, and now it's Audi and Evan. We're caught out, but they jump right out the bushes. Evan's gonna have to flash.
Two flashes.
So is Audi.
Wow, so they go for the red buff for a very cheeky play. Of course, having a teleport for Evan RL means that they can afford to do things like this, but that does not work. Revolta with a trusty smite.
And once again, Rusty, we are one glorious Thunderlords off from something that I have not seen since the start of Season 6. Unfortunately, this teleport gets spent by Evan to go back up to the top side. Okay, so we do have a top Echo. It's just not who we expected.
Okay, yeah. So LeBlanc Pantheon, Porky's decided that he's going to rebel and he's no longer going to be playing a top lane position. That explains the teleport for the Echo. It also solves a lot of problems. They've juked us. However, I don't like being juked.
Seen a lot of LeBlancs getting off some pretty impressive jukes this game, or this entire tournament, we should say. As Revolta moves up towards the top, he's a little low on the health bar, and Evan
he has no stacks.
Got 100, yeah, no stacks right now.
Evan, no flash, I guess, is the big thing. Also has no teleports. Any damage they put down is meaningful damage.
Yeah, he's going to dash, and the flash from Yang. They land the bola, but they just don't have any follow-up damage.
But again, super meaningful. Evan, if he does choose to recall, will not be able to teleport back to lane. Because they tried a really cute play at level 1 by invading that didn't work.
It's a nice attempt from the Latinor squad as Revolta heads back towards River and takes down Scuttle Crab. Consolation prize, but it can't fight back, unfortunately. Imagine if you had an Assassin Crab.
What?
That would add some complexity.
Assassin Crab.
Yeah.
Also, why doesn't Scuttle Crab only go sideways?
That is a really good
Just
question.
Just consider that.
It really should. It doesn't really scuttle, does it?
Nope.
Well, back towards the bottom side. We've got an AD carry LeBlanc now. I guess we call this a kill lane, but everything's a kill lane in Assassin mode. Sei is actually getting pushed back by Kami. This is a little bit different than we expected.
Yeah, it's an Ignite on the Kassadin as well, so he has a little bit more pressure. And does quite well into Diana this early also.
Yeah, Corrupting Potion doing favors for him right now. Don't really expect too much gank heavy action down on the bottom side. Revolta and Audi were both set a little further behind.
Where are you off to?
They're going for a roam, though. Kami's got to watch his back.
They've walked through two wards, and perhaps that's because the blue buff is available. But they're looking for something, but they are... They're not going to get anything. I'm not sure what they're after.
They're taking a lot of time here. They're
but
really trying for
a cheeky deny play. Farm for Kassadin.
Yeah. Well, I mean, once Kami hits 6, he's just not going to care about this at all. And he's been able to keep up in farm, so CB LoL squad lose nothing for this.
They got caught in a tic-tac-toe game or something on stage and just kept clicking while they were walking. Forgot which lane they were in, perhaps, the champions they're playing.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately for them, again, nothing's going to happen. They did have it pushed into the turret so they can freely reset, but this is where they have to be back by, so things work out okay in the end.
I keep trying to compare the farm, and then I remember Evan Earl's up top. That's a weird game.
Yeah,
big wave building.
They've definitely come in with a strategy. We'll say that much.
Now, whether that strategy works, that's a completely different story. As CB LoL built a big wave, they're shoving towards Porky and Ner'Zhul, or rather, they attempted to freeze it for just a minute. Dude's still threatening. With both Pantheons here, this definitely becomes a game of chicken to see who can hop in first, or who can hop in after the fact and nail it. Revolta keeps clearing the crabs out.
It's a very chill game. I'm not used to this.
This is the most relaxed Assassin mode game we've had.
I guess there's just higher expectations to be placed, but Revolta had an advantage for some reason. That advantage is completely gone. The time that he has spent on that top side, perhaps looking for a gank, evened the jungle clear out. And again, a big thing that we are going to look towards when we highlight the champions being played is how important level 6 will be. Diana obviously wants to sit back and scale, as does the Kassadin. And Rengar gets a little bit more gank potential off when he does hit that 6 point.
Yeah, that should be the cue for this game to bust open like a powder keg, but for the time being there, both teams are happy to bide their time and just shove minion waves back and forth at each other. A couple of Doran's bot on either side, and of course the Negatron Cloak finished up for Seiya. Still have to keep an eye on that champion for quite some time, this Diana. We've seen it bust games wide open. Meanwhile, up top, Evan continues to trade one for one with Yang, who's been locked under tower. And the teleport advantage starts to become pretty important here. There's only one on CB LoL's side. Meanwhile, Seiya and Evan both have it. So both top laners, I'm going to use air quotes when I say that, and the mid laner of Team Latin America North.
My immediate expectations go towards the red buff that Revolta is currently at on this Rengar. So if Evan is somehow able to be a really good top laner as well as AD carry, then we might see him ward soon in an area that will spot Revolta before he can even use his ultimate.
Yeah, but Yang's jumped in. He's going to land the chains, and Evan's half-healthed. Can't even get the convergence off, and Yang just too slippery. Meanwhile, Audi and Seiya have gone on a roam here, but Revolta is
bringing around
the red buff, yeah.
Oh, this is a bit awkward.
Okay, so here's the answer to the question. It looks like you can't see the Rengar, and Kami can't finish the job, but Revolta finds Seiya on the bullet strike. They jump for him. Kami waiting to jump in, but Evan's going to tag his way in.
Yang's here as well.
And he jumps. Does he have the damage? It looks like it. That is going to be first blood and some change.
Oh, Audi.
Revolta picks up Evan and gets a double to take down Audi. Blast cones his way further into the jungle, and that's 3 kills for CB LoL.
What a disaster. Oddie revealed himself by walking out of the bush, and Revolta just saw a free kill, opportunity for another free kill, effectively. And now Fire, the CB LoL team, they open it up.
The best part about that is as soon as everybody backs, you can see them buying control wards, and then I was about to laugh and be like, oh, that's a great reason, but then, oh yeah, that doesn't stop invisibility. Anyways.
We do, of course, get to see this again. Rengar only seeing the Kassadin. So going in, Oddie making a big mistake as Revolta was directly behind him, and that's how this trade goes sour for the side of Ice. And this is where Yang comes in to seal the deal and find those kills.
And we answered your question, Rusty.
No, not
Rengars
quite.
Cannot see each other.
They can. It's just the old change.
Oh.
They see the first closest person.
Well, I guess only if you're in the one-on-one situation.
Yeah, that's what we want. We want
there
the...
We go. So Kami was the one who was keeping himself in the front line, and that means that, of course, they were able to take a lot more out of it. So CB LoL jumps out to the first lead this game. 8 minutes in, and they're eyeballing Dragon. This would be the fastest Dragon take we've seen so far.
And it's a mountain trick. If there's one thing assassins cannot do, it's take down turrets. I'd imagine the more mountain drakes you have, the faster you can actually hit them, the one in every 100 sieges that you get. So it could be quite valuable. They may look towards it.
Karma's gonna pick up some honey fruit. Revolta takes down the crab. He's had a seafood diet this game, that's for sure. But the double kill certainly helps him out early on as he has the warrior enchant finished. It's gonna take a little while for Adi to catch up to him. And the rest of LATAM North are playing a little further back.
Now, Dude is hidden here. PBO is just trying to be a bait. I don't think it'll actually work out for them, as Yang's actually mid as well.
Saya has got to watch his back. The man drop incoming will force him away towards the wrong tower. And all of a sudden, there are 4 members of Team Fire right on top of him. And Revolta picks up his 3rd of the game.
Yeah, there may be assassins, but they have a lot of mobility as a result of this. So there's no running away as Saya. And we're not seeing a Miracle Diana performance early into this game just yet. They do keep taking him out. And again, Yang, a big deal, that's all.
Holy moly, Dude's gonna have to flash away, but he may not get away, I don't think so, as Adi will find him. Those Rengars are starting to come up big.
They definitely are. Always a threat, as once again, Yang's just trying to do his best. He can wave clear and half health somebody in one go, because LeBlanc is a dirty, dirty champion.
Yes, indeed. Yang is, like we said, he's a beast, and he's gone for the Magic Pen Boots to start this game off. Still working towards his first completed item, and on the other hand, well, Evan's going to have a while before he gets up to there. He's had to give up a lot of farm just by going up towards topside, and you can tell he's playing a little scared of Yang.
It also looks like a GLP 800 is the item of choice for Kami. Not something you often see with Kassadin, as usually want the Rod of Ages, but GLP immediately scales. Remember, it's Assassin, so you want to be scaled up as quick as possible as they all get their Ghost Blades around their first big item spikes. You want to be just as strong. And I was wondering why we were seeing a Kassadin at all, and maybe this is a supplement to it. Gank the lane, get it ahead at least a little bit, and then let him start to scale up sooner.
Yeah, it's an interesting choice. So keep an eye on Kami in that mid lane and see how his plan works out here. You can already see now back towards the bottom side, PBO starting to get rolling. And he's got a very interesting Ahri build himself.
It definitely does. We've got an AD Ahri. Maybe it'll be a Hextech Gunblade one more time. Again, we've already heard in the interviews that they've had, Brazil have scrimmed Oceania and a couple of other regions, including Turkey. So the build could be consistent throughout all of them.
Yeah. You might say contagious. Definitely seen a lot of Ahris in that AD position, and Adi is going to dodge away from Bola from Revolta. Gives himself up, though, but he's roaming with Kami here, and Ner'Zhul puts the ward down and realizes they may have to back off this turret. 4 members down bottom. Maybe not, as there's not much wave to deal with.
If they are ever going to siege, it does revolve around having the Ahri nearby, even the LeBlanc perhaps, because they're ranged, and you know that's the single most important part before a Pantheon uses his ultimate to get in somewhere.
These guys just don't want to give up the ghosts. Latin American North playing back and letting some tower damage be dealt. The CB LoL roves around. 12 minutes into this game, we've only got 5 kills. I mean, it is a really, really low kill game for an assassin.
Yeah, it is. And Evan RL playing like a typical AD carry would as it hits mid game. He's going to sit in the side lane. This time, he just happens to be an Echo.
First tower blood's going to go down, too, in the mid lane. So Evan, he's going to try to equalize here because there's no one to really answer him. But Yang and Revolta, they may be able to get up there in time to clear the minion wave away. Looks like he won't finish the tower off after all. So CBL is still stacking that gold lead up.
Yeah, and just being invisible means that Evan has to show some respect. The ward going to be cleared. So timing very efficient here from Yang and the rest of the Brazilian teams. Things looking good, honestly, for our red side.
Yeah, there's really nothing to worry about for those guys, but we've seen these games turn on a dime. It's just they're not giving an opening. They're not giving a chance
for
the LATAM North team to really do much. Yeah, they're just, like 50 said, just, you know, laid back.
It's a picnic on Summoner's Rift.
An assassin picnic. And the menu is scuttle crabs.
They really do like those scuttle crabs, actually.
Well, vision's pretty crucial when you have five roamers on each squad, you'd imagine. Speaking of roamers, Adi. Oh, he's a jungler. I guess that's kind of his job.
Yeah. No, he's definitely going to try and do something. Of course, won't find it. Oddie not being as efficient as Revolta in terms of the Rengar off. Unfortunately, we didn't get the LeBlanc off, so to speak, in the lane.
We got juked, man.
As we are, yeah, we all definitely got a pump fake, and they got around us towards the bottom lane, so he's an AD carry.
Also, the Pantheon on Pantheon has not been as exciting as I anticipated.
There's definitely nothing exciting about two Pantheon supports. I will, however, pay my respects much more towards Jude than that of Nerzul, simply because of the item build. Lethality is a really good scaling item in terms of levels, but you may as well just get all of the long swords in the world. Just be PDD. And just smack
get the
people
damage
sooner.
Now. Well, we're starting to see items actually stacking up a little bit more. Yang's got himself Umbrella Nomicon already now. The GLP does get finished. We're still waiting to see if PBO is going to go ahead and turn that Bilgewater Cutlass into an Hextech Bestblade, and then we might start seeing the Rove around from CB LoL as they still are sitting pretty on a 3,000 gold advantage.
It is sitting pretty, but I'll tell you what they are doing. They're sitting boring.
That's true.
They need to work it out.
They need to fight.
Man up. You heard it from Evan. You know what? It was Evan himself that said this is man mode. I am distinctly seeing a lack of that from him right now.
Yeah. Well, we have to call them out when appropriate. And unfortunately, they feel a little bit more inclined to fight the environment. However, they might have the fight brought to them. CB LoL moving in, but they're just only going to find a control ward. You can see Latin America, no, they're just melting away into the night whenever the Brazilians come calling.
They're being afraid. And you know what? Assassins went ahead, usually snowball and win. And when there's five of them, that snowball's a little bit harder. So far, exactly what Brazil want, and the opposite of their opponent.
Oh, dude, Fabio's checked out. He's just playing a video game.
We're at that stage in the game.
Pretty much.
Get in there. Oi.
I've already reverted to that. 15 minutes.
I'm always saying does oi, to be fair.
Yeah, that's true. I guess we haven't reverted to anything. We've pushed ourselves towards the oi stage.
I am uncontrollable in my Australian ways.
Wouldn't have it any other way, Rusty.
I mean, you could, but you're not going to.
I didn't expect it. What I do expect is more fighting. Come on, LATAM. Where's that aggression? Let's see it. You got a Rengar, you got a Diana.
They're looking here, though, for the Diana. They know he's taking the blue buff.
Okay, oh, the man drop. All right, there we go. Take the blue buff away. And they just melt through Saya. Jude even scumbag support steals it.
Yep, Jude also doing a lot of damage, so take it for what it's worth. They find the Diana. Playing it slow, cool, calm, collected, perhaps the CB LoL side is. But they're always making it work. They're the ones with the lead, and the onus is on the opposition side to try and make something happen. Because if they don't, eventually the spillover will be too severe.
I suppose assassins have to have some finesse, and you can clearly see that from the CB LoL squad. Speaking of, let's see it again in an instant replay.
And again, the ward does spot Sayer walking in here. The Pantheon ult was expecting him to run away. Doesn't matter.
Oh!
Oh, good night.
All right. Catfight. Revolta wins.
Revolta definitely does. He's a 4-0-2 Rengar. Was 3-0-2, to be fair. Doing a lot of damage. And they also got the jump first, I believe. There's not a lot of difference in items on them. An extra longsword and upgrade. About 700 gold of AD.
Yep. Mirror matchups is the purest form of outplaying your opponent. Revolta gets spotted on the tail end of that ward, pinged out. But there's nothing Nerzul can really do about it as we get 17 minutes into this game. CB LoL squad just keeps on creeping their lead forward, but you can see them making the proactive plays. They're daring to step into the enemy jungle. And there just isn't an answer from ISIS squad here. Revolta's making a return trip down bottom. In full vision, they land on Nerzul. Diude is able to pick the kill off. Revolta even tanks a tower shot.
Oh!
All right, so Porky gets something back.
They do actually lock it up, so Porky, well done. Having that Morello stops a lot of healing as well. Revolta had his flash. Chose not to use the flash, and perhaps it was the turret attack speed that got him. And as an end result, Rengar dies. The Kami's down here to reinforce the troops.
This should be an easy tower take now, even with only a few minions left. Commies arrived on the scene. They pick that one up, and they just kind of slowly are rotating around and leisurely picking up kills where they will. Only mistake was Revolta overstaying as well.
Yeah, and it was just a mistake in terms of health calculations, perhaps. So, two turrets to zero, topside, the natural progression for the CB LoL team. As after they reset this wave, it could be even more so. No Drake to look towards. There's absolutely nothing else on Summoner's Rift for them to take. And once again, we do get to see how this one progresses, and it's on the back of the charm. That skin, by the way, incredibly hard to actually predict. Revolta could have flashed. Could have done a lot of things.
Oh.
Part of me thinks dude body blocked him. Disappointment.
Momentary disappointment.
It's all right. You're an all right bloke, Revolta. I'll forgive you. Once.
It's a good compliment.
Once.
All right. 5K, though, is what CB LoL have got in the lead. It could have been more if Revolta hadn't died there, but still 7-2 in kills. They've got the tower lead. Yang is on the hunt here. See if he can pick off FNRL. Baited by the minions. Phase dive. He can't get out. That's half his health in a heartbeat.
Yeah, and I mean, he's got an Abyssal Scepter, and still all of this damage comes out of Yang. Perhaps this is the reason we're seeing less and less of the Echoes. It's the first one that we've seen in Assassin mode as well. For those that were confused, there was definitely a Scrying Orb that spotted the ward that he was killing.
Yang's going back in for round number two, but you can tell Elvin's already wise to this. It's the AD carry mentality. Am I half health? Am I going to step forward? I don't think so. He might even try to stop this back. Nope, can't do it.
But by recalling, if he does not teleport Aural, then he will run into a spot of trouble. However, now the ultimate is down. If I were the Pantheon or the Rengar, even from Revolta, I would be making a play. And speak of the devil, after this wave is pushed in, you would expect it. However, really hard to push in an Echo.
Yeah, it's kind of difficult to do, but there's only one outer tower remaining, so you can tell that's the objective. In comes the man drop, Evan. He's stopped up by the chains, nowhere to go, and dudes on him, tagging Revolta. And they triple team.
And that was pretty clean, honestly, from the CB LoL side. It was coordinated. They pressed their buttons at the exact same time. So they're clearly sitting there saying, go. And all at the exact same time get that kill.
Yep. FNRL didn't know what hit him, so now four members strong. The rest of ICE is going to try desperately to stop the push here, but the AllStar tower is going to fall 20 minutes into this game. CB LoL clearly in the lead, but they do not push their luck.
And the blatant disregard of all of these control wards that they do still have a lot of from the Latin American North team doesn't really amount to much when they're so defensive. They're not actually providing any vision or control. And as an end result, further and further ahead they creep.
Yeah, this is the big problem for Latin North. They just aren't making any moves on the map. They're not making huge mistakes, but the little mistakes they're making just keep on stacking up, and eventually...
But they're just not doing anything.
Yeah,
just do it.
If you just keep getting pushed back, what's going to happen? Well, you're going to get pushed back off the edge of a cliff.
You can't just watch them win. You're assassins. You have, like, everyone does this on assassins. Let's be perfectly honest. You go 0-3, you go to a side lane, you die about 10 more times, but you really do give it a go in that side lane. They're just losing.
Yep.
Just man up. Just go.
You've
got to
make
something
happen. We've got the score. You get 0-2-0. 1-2-0. 0-3-0. You need to just dive on somebody, all five members, but they're just not doing it right now.
Press your buttons, man.
All right, well, the dragon's going to spawn up in a minute. Would you guess it? Rusty, it's an Infernal.
Ooh,
it's going to get worse and worse for Latin American North if they don't start making moves. They're going to try to collapse here on Yang, but they're going to give up a dragon no matter what.
Exactly right. So the Drake will go down. A bit of extra damage for an assassin-based team. Kind of scary.
So, but don't be fooled, by the way. That did go on the other side, even though it showed on Latin American North side for a second. Baron's live, and Jude is going in. He's going to land behind Seiya. Oh, the zoning man drop. Diving is Seiya, but exhausted immediately. Yang tags in.
He's out.
Chains were flashed. And Kami can't really close the gap anymore, but they burned a lot of summoners.
Yeah, this time around was just Diyu going man mode. Had the exhaust available, so can afford to do things like that to the Diana, who is 0-3, so doesn't have that instant burst that we were seeing from Syros in the LJL's Diana performance.
It's a very different type of game than what we saw in the LGLs.
They get to hold out, at least. So that's like a minute of extra time bought. We're waiting for the Pantheon ult to be back up again.
And Azul's got his. Problem is, Seiya's got no flash. And he has just played an incredibly defensive Diana. Very strange to see.
Honestly, I think that CB LoL should just do the Baron.
Yeah, I mean, they got a 5-1 Rengar.
They
got a lot of damage.
They've set their sights towards the bottom side of the map. Perhaps they get a pick before they make a play. I was just looking at their team composition. It's Kassadin can get over the wall, LeBlanc can get over the wall, Rengar can ult around, I suppose, in avoid wards. Pantheon can ult, Ahri can. They can all just get inside the pit. Like, right in there.
There's not a lot you can criticize from the CBLOL team this game. The thing is, they've not really had to show anything. They made this game look like a walk in the park with knives.
They actually have. Yeah, it's been way too casual. Super cash, you know? They've got their thongs on. By that, I mean sandals. God, my bad. I am Australian.
I figured that's what you were going for, but Porky was going for getting out of danger, and Revolta still finishes him off with the Bullet Strike. Saya TP's in. Finally, they've decided to make moves, but it just looks like too little and too late. Evan, Ner'Zhul, Saya all on the chase, but it is just not enough. Revolta gets tagged by the Bola, and they jump for him. But that Blast Cone was clutch.
Surprisingly clutch. Almost cost Revolta more than he would have liked. Didn't get over the Dragon Pit with his team, but does get out safely, so CBLOL can continue this onslaught as they're looking further, not finding. It's more about Kami.
Yep, keep the split push casting going. Let's do this. The GLP is starting to pay work. Let's see if PBO can make a play. He tries, and he stays alive, and Revolta tags in to kill Saya. Meanwhile, down bottom, further Yang is looking for Ner'Zhul, still has a minion wave to work with, and Evan is going to have to chrono break, but Kami is on the chase. He dashes, he dives. But it's not enough. Kami with a big kill.
Absolutely no chance, unfortunately, this time around for Evan RL on the bottom side of the map. Lots of fighting has continued to happen. And again, not recalling, not relenting, and just being constantly aggressive. The response from LAN, sit down and take it. It's a little bit saddening. It's disheartening. I want them to do better.
Yeah, CBLOL just keeps slowly turning up the heat knob. And Latin America North are starting to crack under the pressure here. It is two kills. They are trying to make plays, but they're all reactive. The Brazilians are choosing where and when they want to fight, and there just has not been a quick enough response. And as a result, you can see the waves pushing in on all three lanes. There just is no answer.
Everything completely belonging to CBLOL, as he is using that to clear vision, because that indicates the Baron is where they actually want to go towards. As we do get to see this fight again on the bottom side, it was surprisingly a bait. Saya thought he could get PBO. He could not get PBO because Ahri has a lot of mobility and he's the one that gets baited in. Incidentally, of his own mistakes. Kami going for a turret. Evan thought he could take advantage of that fact and ignite. Kind of a big deal against an Echo who does go down.
Yeah, and Kami just making that look simple enough. You can see why he took the build. He did, and Porky! He dives in, he dashes out, they tag in the rest, and Revolta might be isolated. This should be a big shutdown. Adi gets some revenge. A rare big play here for LATAM North, but they still lose a tower down bot.
Yeah, again, another movement from CBLOL. They have the win effectively in their sights. They're looking for it, and getting the turrets is another step in that direction. Still, we're waiting for the items to be seen from the opposition side. Maybe they can group up and make a big effort together, because again, Assassins ahead or behind still have a lot of base damages. However, Saya.
Well, there's the man drop. Dude just keeps on using that to zone out. Instant exhaust down, and they should finish him off. Dude got a little dangerously low there, but unfortunately for Saya, he just couldn't take the 1v2. Starting to learn, starting to play a little bit better, and you can see him picking up a few more items. He does finish his Nashor's Tooth. We saw Evan had already gotten himself the Lich Bane, but you know, when you're 26 minutes into an Assassin's Mode game, you expect these items to be done a lot sooner.
You absolutely do. You also expect more than 15 kills total in 26 minutes. A little bit more cool, calm, and collected from the CBLOL side. And from what I've been hearing, their scrims were definitely not like this, so I'm not going to put onus on them. They want it. And a Trinity Force, apparently, is what Ahri wants.
Yeah, that's not a build I see every day. But AD Ahri and Mixed Damage Ahri has been the build du jour. So PBO just says, let's have some fun with it and see what we can get. And, you know, to his credit, he has definitely improved his score over the last time we saw him play. Last game it was, it was normal summoners, but it was PBO.
Oh. There you go.
Let's see how this works. He still hasn't upgraded his boots, by the way. He just hasn't had to.
Oh, Audi.
Audi! He gets taken down. That's going to be a big double kill for Kami in the mix. Looking for Ner'Zhul, the triple kill. Chrono break back. Kami is still alive in this one. Porky picks up Gank for revenge. Revolta, the quadra kill.
Oh, no,
can he do the fifth flashing, shutting down, no! Saya denies the Penta, but they still nail the ace.
Carly was already dead, so there was no chance of him getting a Penta.
That was crazy. He already used Ignite. I thought it was on the last champion.
Not exactly a denial.
I'm going crazy, Rusty.
You're definitely going crazy, but Brazil still get another one team fight. They're now pushing towards the bottom side of the base. Would be an inhibitor at the very least. As 5 seconds roughly to the rest of the team. We'll see if they can get it. They're pushed off beforehand. You need to calm down.
I do, man. I just wanted the action for so long and it didn't come. They do get the inhibitor. Kami makes himself quite a bargain, 4-for-1. And now on the chase, it just is too little too late. These guys just don't have the damage. They're getting kited out. Dude is able to dodge the chains. Audi does come around from the backside, but a pair of teleports now as he jumps onto Dude, who man drops right on top of the teleport, and they knock down Saya.
That worked somehow. Revolta's still going.
Yep, double kill. Revolta's found more, and he looks for Porky, and nails him with the Bola, looking for another shutdown, finally, by Evan, who chrono breaks back onto Yang, and there's the action. What? They get them all down almost again.
Here comes Kami.
Uh-oh, Evan stopped. Iced by Kami. 3-for-4.
Kami's definitely still looking for the Rengar. Note that he has no mana to use his ultimate again, so he has to show some respect here. It's a big Kassadin, but when the big Kassadin isn't there, LAN have a chance.
That appears to be the opening, but we've suddenly gone from 2 and 11 at the 25 or so minute mark. I've lost track at this point. To 8 to 21 in kills. It's just cracked wide open, and here was one of many reasons why.
Incidentally, making a great play here, Dude, as he goes in, actually finding Seiya's teleport, gets the stun off, and they instantly destroy him. He was using it, I believe, for that purpose, but at the same time was running. Revolta flashes because he wants the third. Sick bowler, but instantly dies. So no chance of a Penta this time around either. As a result of all of this fighting, Yang completely left alone to flash into a wall.
Yep, Seiya and Kami are going to go at it again, but Dude's there to tag, and it really is no such thing as a true 1v1 in any of these. But yeah, it was a really, really nice ultimate by Evan RL. I mean, that kind of saved LAN's chances there to, you know, leave one and one champion up on either side. All the same, Revolt is going to be able to easily solo out another dragon, so they've got themselves a little disco in their step. Earth, Wind, and Fire now.
Do you remember?
When this game was a snooze fest?
The 21st night of September.
Oh, that was a different line than I was expecting. All right, Seiya's caught again, but he goes on to Yang. Orbit Deception comes back around again, and PBO is out.
Rengar's still looking. Of course, he can only see the closest member being Liara. He doesn't know where LeBlanc is, but still searching. As it really just freaks you out, having this thing over your head and your screen change a different shade of color.
It's been unsettling. And now the Baron has been started, and it is just getting shredded by CBLOL. No chance to contest, nobody in the area. And they make quick work of it to pick up a big buff.
Yeah, they absolutely do. The gold lead's pretty much insurmountable. They should be able to utilize this buff, as they're not waiting for someone to walk in and clear vision. They're actually waiting to use their ultimates in unison. They know they're on a control ward, so they're actually in a safe zone. As actually...
Wait just a minute. There's still two sitting here. Dude, PBO...
This is way too many people without having Rengar nearby.
Kami might be caught. Just kidding.
He is a level 16 or above Kassadin. He's not caught. They're never really actually caught.
Now they're just playing with their food.
They are, actually.
Still, Latin America North have finally found some fire. They've woken up a little bit, but it is just so late in the game to do it. Revolta hops in, and that damage is huge. But Evan RL puts a bit back on before falling to Kami, and Adi is running. Nah, cannot get away. Yang picks up another big one. That is two quick kills, and it sends the rest of ICE scrambling back to their base.
And the charm doesn't connect. It doesn't really matter because Ari at this stage is just a charm bot. The rest of his team has definitely scaled. This Kassadin is a monster.
And Kami just pushes forward onto Ner'Zhul. Another inhibitor is going to get fired down, and they are on to Nexus turrets. Dude is flashing and stunning, and they are dishing out so much damage back to the fight.
Yeah.
Yang tries to make a big play, but he ends up taking his own life.
And now they've got no health left. Yanger makes the exact same mistake that, believe it or not, Mythy made on LeBlanc. Has now got a lockout period when you use the W, so there's no going back. You have to actually staying under a, you know, a base turret. He's asking to die, so we do get to see the actual starting of this fight and Revolta's damage, namely 780 crit. Evan showing that he's got good mechanics still on the Echo to do damage, but Kami is a massive, massive Kassadin. And he's pretty much destroying everybody to ever exist. As that's a feels bad, man.
Well, not as much as they have to feel bad in this game. They've done a quite excellent job at locking out Latin America North pretty much every chance they've got, but it is just so brutal. They are so close to knocking it down. If one thing had gone different, they land that charm, Yang doesn't YOLO into the fountain, they pretty much win the game right there.
Shoutouts to Kami, good bloke, big fan, has Mage Eyes. That's top. What I want to see.
Top tier build. I love this build, actually. Do you think this game goes on a while longer? Not that it's going to. He sells the GLP and just, like, I don't know, picks up something else.
A death cap?
Another, yeah.
Fedius would be happy then.
Fedius would be really happy. Well, he's not happy with this game anyways because there's no Katarina.
Yeah, I guess. No, that's fair. But I'm happy there's no Katarina.
Yeah, I'm okay with that, to be honest. Surprised, but okay with it. More surprised by this Diana. Seiya just has not been nearly as effective as we could have expected, but you know, maybe we're ruined a little bit by Sarah stepping it up.
Yeah, so we're kind of at the point of the game where Diana can be matched by Kassadin in terms of split pushing. So there is no real 1-4 type of threat. Kami's just going to sit bottom. They'll send one or two to him, perhaps more to him, and that's where Brazil will just... This is actually fairly standard League of Legends.
Yep. Well, it's definitely not standard Assassin's Mode, but, you know, they've gone the more macro track this whole game, and as a result, CBLOL have left very few openings.
Remember, Latin
America doesn't get back.
Again, the Baron buff, top lane inhibitor is already dead. They're playing it slow, minions are about to crash, so this is the wave where you actually see them start to make some moves from the CBLOL team.
There we go. Just wait until there is no resistance off, and they just keep knocking down the inhibitors.
Again,
that will be the
no
last
resistance.
One.
Come on,
they
man.
Just can't do it.
Just do it.
This has been one of the longest games we've had on Assassin Mode 2, by the way. We're getting close to 35 minutes.
Use your Pantheon button.
The minions are all coming. This is the last chance saloon here.
Double stack of cannons as well. Oh, supers, rather.
Oh, Kami goes in. Porky! Yee! Okay. Back to Fountain with you.
Porky's name just added a couple of Ys to it.
I don't usually spell well on broadcast either. Math is one of my things I can't do. That's another one. Seiya now.
This could be
fired
in.
Low. They jumped the Bola. Man drops incoming. Seiya has gone golden, and they found you. They found Kami. But who's found who? Shutdowns are flying, and the damage is just too real. He was trying for it, but that's a shutdown. Audi goes down, and it's Seiya and Porky left to defend the base. Nothing left now as they take Dude for their troubles. They won't finish the game!
They have to recall the fantastic sieging of assassins on Summoner's Rift is now entirely evident. As with two people still left alive.
Revolta ignited, Porky flashing.
Oh!
And he just can't do it!
What?
He just turns around! And he autos him! And that's the ace! That's it! 35 minutes, they just like, why not? Let's finish this game. It's all Nexus, boys. And CBLOL. Walking the park, wipe the single bead of sweat off their brows.
We just watched an entire game of League of Legends in Assassin mode, and that last 10 seconds has made me just distinctly hate Rengar infinitely more than I did beforehand. That was disgusting.
Kami has a giggle at the end of it all, and he was, believe it or not, one stack away from full Magi's. And that was pretty much the way you sum this game up.
That was, I guess it was a controlled victory from the CBLOL region.
Somehow they found a way to play control mages.
They out-assassinated the assassins who were playing like supports, unfortunately. I think is what we can say to contrast this victory for CBLOL, but another fire win.
Big fire victory. So they got 4-0 in assassin mode today, and that is, considering how close the games were yesterday on Summoner's Rift and the 1v1 coming down to the final game, Team Ice needs to find something left. Otherwise, they are in serious danger of, you know, losing out insurmountably.
Yeah, I believe they need nothing short of a miracle. So the 1v1s have to go both to ice, I would imagine, is the next best step. But kicking it off on the perfect foot here is Team Fire.
Oh yeah, big statement for them in all of the Assassin Mode games. This one being a much more one-sided affair than any of them, in fact.
The closest Assassin game, I would say, to a stomping is, you know, do what you can. Not everybody plays Assassins. Granted, I definitely do not play Assassins.
No, I couldn't do anything.
I know Stress doesn't play LeBlanc as an example for you on top of that, but, you know, Brazil clearly do.
Yeah, and they definitely made it work for them. I think the casting was something we weren't quite expecting because, you know, we talked up Kami as maybe playing something a little bit different, but he did a really, really good job, and not just him alone. The whole team, Revolta in the early game, we thought maybe he was going to get outbuffed, and then he turns it around back on Audi and, you know, said, no, let me show you how to Rengar.
Yeah, and he definitely did. He outran God, to say the least.
Pretty much. So with that, that's it for us. Hingers is standing by with Revolta himself. Let's hear more about that victory.
Thank you, guys. All right, I'm here now with Superstar Jungle Revolta. You look like you had a great game that time. Yeah, you having fun?
Yeah, Assassin Mode, super fun.
But yeah, you it was kind of a slow start to the game, though. Was that your guys' strategy going in, or just how the game played out?
Oh, actually, we were about to gank top, and then we failed hard. And I was like, oh, I'll just wait for level 6, guys. Let's just wait for Cassidy and Power Spike. And then at level 6, the game just went off for us.
Also, we saw Kami kind of fail with a pentakill, almost get it. In the comms, though, how annoyed was he?
Oh, he didn't even realize, I guess, because he didn't speak about it. Like, I didn't even see that he got a quadra kill, actually.
Yeah. All right, and finally, you're about to head into the 1v1 tournament. Give us a sneak peek. Are we going to see Rengar again in the 1v1s?
Well, I think I'm going to put everything on Yang and Kami because I'm so bad at 1v1s that I wish they win everything so they don't, like, need me anymore.
Awesome. Well, there we have it, guys. Revolta, not very confident going into the 1v1s. That's enough from us here. We'll send it over to Sifu at the desk to break down that game.
Thank you very much, Hingers. Now I'm kind of excited to see what Revolta brings to the tables when we do get to those 1v1s later in the day. But talking about this matchup, looking at the picks and bans, we finally got that Kasten versus Diana matchup. Kami took the risk and he played up against it. Mithy, can you run us through why Kasten does so well there?
Well, basically, Diana wants to farm until level 6, and Kasten loves farming to level 6 because it's an even better champion at 6. So. If you know that the enemy team is going to pick Diana, you can just go Kasten and you have a free lane. You can even pressure the Diana a little bit in lane, and you're just going to be much, much stronger the later the game goes. The main issue with Kasten mid is that you're blind picking a Kasten into so many things that could be possible, and playing against a Pantheon mid, for example, would be a disgrace for you.
In the end, though, does get the matchup, so it works out. And of course, combined with the power of Revolta, it does feel like he was able to pull out an incredibly effective early game. So if we take a chance to look at some of those early kills, we can see exactly how Brazil found those early leads.
Yeah, and it kind of goes back to the pressure game overall, the fact that level 1 went so well for them, although we're actually going to take a look at the mid gank. So this is already after Revolta has gotten that snowball going. He teams up with Kasten, and he's now going to snowball the mid lane ahead. And as soon as those two champions are ready to go, it's just about moving that power point wherever they want on the map.
Just piling everything on Sia time and time again. And this was actually reminiscent. I know this was Assassin's Mode. This was reminiscent of what happened in yesterday's game when Naru was playing up against them on Summoner's Rift in the regular mode. Because after this, the LATAM North team just don't really seem to know what to do if Sia is behind. The jungler ends up being behind in the matchup as well. And you know, Adi kind of goes, I don't really know how to compensate for this. And LATAM North just kind of sit back and sit at their turrets, and suddenly they lose mid tower, like everything goes wrong.
And that's what's to be expected, and you have fundamental changes to the vision game. So as soon as you lose that initial snowball, you pretty much just have to watch yourself bleed out, so Latin America North can do nothing but hide under their towers.
Well, bleeding out, you talk about that, but it took a very long time. One of our longest games in the Assassin modes, if not the longest. Why was this, you know, such a marathon in terms of Assassin mode, at least?
It was the Baron. So the fact that, okay, you're on Assassins, their struggle at sieging, so the Baron is a big issue for trying to siege. Well, they got so far ahead so quickly that they almost had to kind of waste time, essentially, until they could do the Baron safely enough. Because at 20, 22 minutes, you have no one to tank that. Everyone's super soft and very squishy. So if Latin America North are just hiding under the tower, Brazil are standing there like, well, what are we supposed to do? They're hiding from us. We're just going to bounce back and forth. We're going to wait until it's safe enough or try to make a pick.
Interesting, Mithy. Did you have any thoughts? Is there anything you think that Brazil could have done better to kind of execute there at the end of the game?
I think that Brazil did a good job. As soon as you get mid tower so early, especially when you have a Kasten in your team, you're basically prone to lose the game, honestly, if the other team plays well. And I think Brazil did a good job at snowballing mid tower into bot tower, into top tower. And then tried to pressure the tier 2s, which is not really an easy thing to do, but they managed to put enough resources on the tier 2 bot that basically made them able to get the tier 2 top lane on the other side. So I think they did a good job at just stalling time and, like Frostcurrent said, wait until they can actually do Baron, because even though it's 20 minutes and they have full pressure in the game, no one can tank it. And it's such a risk to walk into Baron and, let's say, they get an orb there, they get some kind of way of figuring out that they're doing Baron, they can all fight them there and they will all die because they're taking so much damage from the Baron.
Yeah, and I mean, at the end of the day, Brazil closing it out, and that is yet another win for Team Fire. So with Assassin's Mode done, let's take the opportunity to look at how the teams stand, starting with Team Fire, who are above and away our big team here. Japan 3-0, Turkey 2-0, Southeast Asia and Brazil each 1-1 respectively, and that puts Team Fire at 7-2.
They certainly have brought the fire today, that's what you can say, with a clean sweep so far. I mean, Ice need a good performance in the 1v1 so they don't get frozen out of day two here.
Well, absolutely, because that's the big... I mean, I'll accept the puns. Pyra is, like, all full of them, so one on the Jasper is perfectly acceptable per segment. But we take a chance to look at the Team Ice segments, or the Team Ice standings, and we have to keep in mind, as you can see here, 1-1, 1-1. Those guys are at the top of the bracket. We've got 0-2 and 0-3 on the bottom, and what this means is that if Fire is able to take both sets of upcoming 1v1s, they have secured 3 slots in the bracket stage.
Which means that there's only one slot available for Team Ice if the 1v1s turn out in Fire's favor, which it has been all day. Which means that it was super important that CIS actually lost for the rest of Team Ice, because now they're one, like, it's much closer. Everyone's looking at each other like, okay, I don't need to outrun the bear, I just need to outrun the other guy.
Just leave the man behind, see who they can sacrifice, see who can just make it to the top of the sinking ship that is Team Ice right now. Maybe they can turn it around today. They have opportunities to turn it around tomorrow, but after the break, we'll be throwing our All-Stars into the Howling Abyss as the IWCA 1v1 tournament continues.
Easier.
He jumps. Does he have the damage? It looks like it. That is going to be first blood and some chain.
All right, there we go. Take the blue buff away. And they just melt through Seiya.
Tag in the rest, and Revolta might be isolated. This should be a big shutdown. Duel, the triple kill. Chrono break back. Kami is still alive in this one. Porky picks up Gank for revenge. Revolta, the quadra. Flashing and stunning, and they are dishing out so much damage back to the Fountain. Yang tries to make a big play.